So these are the branch that I'm from. We're developing emerging materials. And so we have metals, ceramics, and composites, and capabilities. And what we're doing in an example of what we're doing in metals is looking at innovative processing. So instead of taking a chunk of metal and basically getting rid of 95% of it to get to a shape that you're looking for, what we're doing is building from the bottom up. So take a wire, and then you melt it with E-beam, and use a CAD program to basically direct where it goes until you build the shape to net shape without wasting a lot of material. And it reduces cost. This one is another net shape fabrication that was done in collaboration with a company in Germany, where this is actually a single piece. And so instead of taking out 95% of the material and then putting in the stiffeners, they actually build in, take one piece, make it a flat piece, and form it into the shape with the stiffeners already in place. So it saves money, it reduces weight because you don't have welds. So that's for metals, and we're looking at some nanotechnology. So currently what we're looking at for reduced weight is using carbon fibers. These have been around for a long time. They've been around for about 50 years. And you see them as sporting goods and things. But we also use it for aerospace. Okay, so you start out with a carbon fiber, and we develop the resins so that we can get structural pieces like this. So these are a fraction of the weight of steel or aluminum. But the next generation beyond that we're looking at is called the nanotubes. And so it looks like this. It starts out looking like dust, but the properties of this are significantly better than the carbon fiber. So if you look at, this is the stiffness and this is the strength which it breaks. This is where the fiber is. So carbon nanotubes theoretically have like 20 times stronger. They're 20 times stronger and they're also lighter. And so we're looking at how to take advantage of using these materials to change our designs, for example. So one of the things we're considering is if you're able to save this much weight because the material is much stronger, you might be able to do single stage to orbit instead of two stage to orbit launch. So that would be game changing for us. And so what we're doing is not just working on our own in the lab, but also working from the suppliers all the way to the users, so that we're trying to accelerate the maturation of these materials. Because people tend to think of it as it's an emerging material, it'll take 50 years for it to get into use. We're trying to look at ways of taking advantage of this sooner by working differently, working across the disciplines together and then across the supply chain. We're also looking at self-healing materials. The kind of self-healing we're looking at is puncture healing. So the way we test it is we actually take it to the gun range. So this has been shot by bullets and they heal instantly. So why do we need that? For things like the habitat, you know, like when you have micrometeoroid damage, it prevents damage by catastrophic failure by just sealing up the hole. Okay. And so what we've done is made that, trying to understand what the mechanism of that, so we can design our own material because it operates at a different operational window. And then we've also used it to make composites. So this is kind of the glue that holds together that fiber. And what we've done is looking at how this might be more damage tolerant. So it repairs, rather than repairing itself, what we've done is actually impacted this, looked at the damage, measured the property, and then healed it, and then measured the properties again. And when we healed it, you don't see the damage by C scan, ultrasonic scan, and then the properties recovered to about 95% of the original. So it helps us with damage tolerance from ground impact. And the last thing I was going to show is engineered surface. So what we're looking at is engineering a surface to prevent bugs from sticking to aircraft wings. And the reason it matters is because when you have laminar flow, depending on the size of your aircraft and the distance you're traveling, you could save up to 30% of fuel, okay, especially in long distance. But when you have bugs and it sticks up, it trips the flow, and so it's a lot rougher, and so you reduce the laminar flow. So